Hello, I'm Eric Lepowski from Princeton University, where I am advised by Professor Alex Glaser, and I will be presenting recent work with our InspectorBot, which is a robotic neutron detector with spectral and directional sensitivity for nuclear verification tasks. And this project is a close collaboration with Professor Rob Goldston at the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory. I'll begin by addressing why we're interested in robotics for verification inspections. International agreements and treaties require on-site inspections to verify the absence of undeclared nuclear material, including enriched uranium and plutonium. Currently, handheld radiation measurements are a useful tool, but they are inherently intrusive as they require the inspector to be granted access to the facility being inspected, and they can also be rather costly or undesirable for routine inspections. Such inspections can require considerable time, planning, and resources. Just this year, the IAEA released a report detailing priorities for enhancing nuclear verification capabilities, which included the need for reliable, secure, portable, and user-friendly instrumentation for detecting HEU production at declared LEU enrichment facilities. Given these various rationales, we believe that if designed properly, autonomous robotic inspectors may be able to perform radiation measurements in support of such verification and do so less intrusively and more effectively, efficiently, and safely than current human-based methods. So, our goal with this project is to develop a robotic inspector capable of localizing and characterizing an anomalous radioactive source when no significant neutron emitters are declared or expected to be present. This project entails developing and implementing a new detector configuration in addition to considering how robots can be used to monitor the nuclear fuel cycle or be used to perform treaty verification. Starting with safeguards, we could envision confirming the absence of clandestine withdrawal stations in the centrifuge hall of a gas centrifuge enrichment facility. The U-234 in UF6 emits neutrons by alpha N reactions on fluorine, and since U-234 attracts with U-235 through the enrichment process, the neutron emissions can be indicative of the level of uranium enrichment. As an arms control example, we can consider confirming the absence of undeclared warheads in a storage facility. In this case, we would be measuring the neutrons emitted by plutonium-240. In both of these applications, there are limitations. Scanning all the centrifuges in a cascade hall can be very time-intensive and difficult to perform routinely, and access to storage facilities may be very limited. Focusing now on the InspectorBot design, it is comprised of the three boron-coated straw detectors azimuthally distributed within a cylinder of high-density polyethylene. You'll see in the cross-section of the MCMP model that there are three detectors in the current design with room for six. The polyethylene attenuates neutrons as they travel through the system, which generates a neutron flux gradient between the detectors. The entire detector system is surrounded by a thin cadmium casing to shield the detectors from an influx of thermal neutrons, thereby preserving that flux gradient. And then the entire detection system is all mounted on an omnidirectional robotic platform, which is capable of remote control or program movement. On the left here, we see the InspectorBot located in the TFTR test cell at PPPL. On the right in the photo is a containerized californium-252 source, and we perform 5-minute measurements with the InspectorBot facing directly toward the californium source, meaning that one of the three detectors was straight ahead, with the other two detectors equidistant in the back. We used these experimental measurements to calibrate our MCMP model. On the right, we see the result of the experimental measurements compared to the calibrated MCMP model, and we see excellent agreement. The curve fitting here also reveals that the drop-off with respect to distance is shallower than an inverse square law, which is traditionally used in radiation detection, and we attribute this deviation to the environment. Although the test cell is a very large room, especially compared to the size of our system, including the full room in the MCMP model was crucial for achieving this good model agreement. Then using the calibrated MCMP model, we also determined the efficiency of the three detector system to be around 3%, neglecting the effects of solid angle and reflection from the environment. So in real life scenarios, we can actually expect slightly higher count rates. If we briefly think back to our goal, we're interested in localizing and characterizing unknown neutron sources. While many reported methods for source localization rely on only the total detector counts, The detector configuration in our SpectraBot provides us with spectral and directional sensitivity, the former of which also allows us to characterize a source. So here we demonstrate that the front-to-back ratio is indicative of the source energy. We define the front-to-back ratio as the counts in the forward detector facing directly toward the source divided by the ratio of the counts in the back two detectors. This plot shows that in the sub 2 MeV range, the front-to-back ratio can change rather dramatically as a function of source energy. As the energy decreases, the ratio increases, and as the energy increases, the ratio asymptotes towards unity since more energetic neutrons penetrate further into the polyethylene and reach the back detectors. By using these results from monoenergetic sources, we can actually also predict the front-to-back ratio produced by distributed energy sources by weighting the monoenergetic results by the source spectrum and the detector efficiency as a function of energy. In addition to the spectral sensitivity, our NSpectraBot was designed specifically to provide directional sensitivity. We again perform experiments to benchmark our MCMP modeling where the robot was rotated in place. What we see in open space is that the counts versus angle curve closely resembles a cosine wave, so we represent the angular dependence of the detected counts by the simple model here. The counts in each detector are modeled by A plus B cosine, where the direction within the cosine is the relative rotation of the detector and the angular offset theta naught. This gives us a simple system of three equations and three unknowns, A, B, and theta naught, which is the estimated direction toward the source. With the counts from each of the three detectors, we can solve this system of equations with a single set of measurements. And the power of this is that we can estimate the direction toward a source using only a single set of measurements. Also important to note that for the six detector configuration, the same model will hold. However, least squares regression is then used to determine theta naught, since the number of equations then exceeds the number of unknowns. I'd also like to take a moment just to discuss an alternative, perhaps more intuitive mechanism for estimating the direction. Just as a human may rotate a detector from left to right until the detector signal is maximized, we could also rotate the robot until the counts in a single detector are maximized and the counts in the back two detectors equal each other. However, this process would require several iterative measurements, whereas the simple cosine model presented here is a single shot measurement. In addition to modeling the directional sensitivity in open space, we performed experiments for a couple cases where the SpectraBot and californium source were positioned near a concrete wall. Again, the robot is rotated in place, but now there is significant neutron reflection due to the presence of the wall. In these plots, I show two of these cases, the specific configurations of which are depicted in the drawings above, where the white circle represents the SpectraBot and the black circle represents the source. Intuitively, the direction toward the source would be the angle where the curves from the two lower count detectors intersect. The gray vertical lines show the directional estimate provided by the cosine model for each of the five discrete measurements which make up the orange curves. And what we see is that with only the three data points of a single set of measurements, the cosine model predicts the angle which maximizes the counts in the forwardmost detector with reasonable accuracy. In visual terms, the gray lines are all clustered around the intersection point of the bottom two orange curves. These results also demonstrate the effect of neutron reflection, where the vertical black line shows the true direction toward the source, yet the detected direction is shifted by approximately 10 to 25 degrees due to the nearby wall. Now that we have this method for performing directional measurements, we were interested in studying the accuracy of the method. So here I show the directional error as a function of orientation. The error plotted here is the error that's intrinsic to the curve fitting process, and it is a systematic error. However, we can reduce the systematic error by increasing the number of detectors within the polyethylene cylinder. In fact, the error decreases exponentially with respect to the number of detectors. We have also verified by MCMP simulations that by doubling the number of detectors from 3 to 6, the total detected count rate increases by 99%, so there's minimal inter-detector interference. In addition to the directional error, we also evaluate the directional uncertainty. We analytically perform uncertainty propagation from the counts in each detector to the estimated direction. The plot here on the left shows the analytically calculated directional uncertainty compared to the 1 sigma standard deviation from a Monte Carlo study, which we take as the ground truth. And what we see is that for varying source strength and signal to background ratios, there is generally good agreement, thereby validating our uncertainty calculation. This plot also serves to demonstrate that the 6 detector system achieves the same directional uncertainty as the 3 detector system with double the source signal. Or put another way, the 6 detectors can achieve the same uncertainty in half the time. And on the right here, I show that there's a linear relationship between the uncertainty in the total detected counts and the directional uncertainty. And these results simply serve to give us confidence for applying our inspector bot and our measurement methods to our proposed applications. So, the expected impact of this work is to develop a detection system for autonomously performing verification inspections in support of safeguards and arms control. And in this presentation, I focused on the detector side of the project. However, we are also pursuing work on algorithms to help bring our vision to fruition. This project would not be possible without the collaboration with PPPL, including the experimental campaign used for calibration, as well as planned future campaigns which we hope to conduct to test the 6 detector system and for implementing the directional measurements experimentally. Through a series of experimental measurements and MCMP modeling, we've examined the performance of our inspector bot and demonstrated the spectral and directional sensitivity of the detection system. Specifically for application to our work in source localization, we demonstrate a simple yet robust method for performing single-shot directional measurements. And we also show that by doubling the number of detectors from 3 to 6, we reduce the systematic error in the direction by a factor of 70, while also achieving the same directional uncertainty with half the source signal or half the measurement time. And this motivates the second iteration of our inspector bot, which contains 6 detectors. To conclude, as a reminder, our vision with this project is to develop an autonomous mobile robot for nuclear safeguards and arms control, which is capable of localizing and characterizing an anomalous radioactive source when no significant neutron emitters are expected or declared to be present. So now that we have this well-characterized instrument, we're interested in applying our inspector bot to specific applications, such as detecting a hidden withdrawal station or low-enriched uranium feed stations. We're also continuing to develop our previous work on source localization, which merges our directional model and uncertainty propagation in the context of a particle filter. And we are working towards simulating a realistic test case of source localization, thereby merging everything above into specific scenarios where we can really start playing with the autonomous nature of this project. Thank you so much for listening, and I'll conclude by thanking MGV for supporting this work.